Well, boys, looks like you started the fun without me.
You're all sick. Every last one of you.
We're going to need a bigger gun.
What's the matter? You scared of things that go boom?
Give me one goddamn reason why I shouldn't blow your goddamn brains all over that goddamn wall.
My name is Eric, and you're Michael.
I am.
And we're doing two movies today. Which two movies are we doing today?
The two movies that we are covering today are Insomnia and The Rock.
All right, a great double feature. Normally we would talk about movies we've seen here, and I guess that's become the format.
Yeah.
So we've both been working on different music things, and we've had basically no time for a film.
Zero.
So there's music projects now, and then like in the last couple of days, we've kind of been getting excited for this first film thing. So maybe there'll eventually be news on that. That'll be kind of cool.
Mm-hmm.
So for now, spoilers.
Spoiler alert.
This is a spoiler warning. So we're going to be talking about both of these films and maybe referencing another couple films.
Yeah.
So if you have not seen either Insomnia or The Rock, you should see those movies and then you should listen to this podcast.
Turns out the end of Insomnia is that Bruce Willis is already dead.
Do you think Al Pacino stayed up for days to prepare for this part?
I would not put that past him.
Yeah, that seems like an Al Pacino
thing.
He's
a method guy.
Is he? I wasn't sure about that or not.
He's a method guy. Can't go wrong with Al Pacino.
Sure.
He's a really good actor. He tends to play the same roles. Not the same people.
I can kinda see
that. Not the same characters, but the same roles. The hard cop role or the big business role.
I haven't, I can't really agree with that. The last couple, I've accidentally been seeing all these Al Pacino movies.
Well, okay, I wanna first off take an aside and say his later career because everything else was gangster movies.
Okay, yeah, that's fair. I guess you would call Dog Day Afternoon a gangster movie, maybe, kind of, and definitely Scarface. But the later stuff, okay, so you have like, what am I thinking of recently? All right, so you have 88 Minutes, which we won't count.
Yeah, that's bad.
But then you have this, you have... Well, I don't know. What about like Simone?
Big business.
Big business, kind of. Would you say Devil's Advocate is big business?
Yeah.
Would you count that as big business? All right. I can kind of see that.
He always plays the big suit guy, you know, the head honcho type.
Mm-hmm. Or the detective.
Yeah. And that's not bad. I mean, he's good at it and I like watching him.
I'm still hesitant to agree about
that's
that
fine.
At all. I'll grant you.
I'm right. And
so how was he as the big suited detective?
He was good. Yeah. He was good. Hilary Swank was... kind of white, you know,
she was
blasé.
Transparent for me, which is all I really needed.
And Robin Williams was nothing special.
Mm-hmm.
I would go so far as to say that none of the actors really moved outside of what I would consider a comfort zone. We're not seeing any Heath Ledger as the Joker here.
Yeah, right.
I mean, nobody was bad. Nobody acted poorly. There was no Jenna Malone, Kevin Smith type thing.
Yeah, right.
It was just, you know, pretty straightforward acting. I mean, there's nothing really I can comment about on the acting, unfortunately. And that's a lot coming from me.
Sure.
But there's nothing that I would pick out negatively too, which is a big plus.
Hilary Swank, I was a little afraid of at first and
I think
she was fine in this.
I've never seen her do anything that I consider particularly good.
Uh-huh.
I've seen her in a few things and she kind of always just ends up being in a film more or less.
I do want to say Robin Williams in this surprised me because Robin Williams was one of those people and I'll mention Nicolas Cage about this later, but who kind of fools me into thinking I like love all their stuff and need to see it all and whatever. And at some point I just realized I looked back through the Robin Williams stuff and I just despise it.
Yeah.
There's a few exceptions, Death to Smoochie, but that's not because of Robin Williams at all. I think they just kind of gave him the character that, you know, Robin Williams needs to play.
I don't know. I think he was great in that film.
Yeah. Well, he was great in that film, but I don't know.
He pulls the weight, dude.
Yeah. He was great in Death to Smoochie. I mean, I guess I shouldn't knock him for that. But
I know you disagree, but I love Hook and I love him in Hook.
The Hook's a terrible film. I had 1 hour photo, which was he was creepy in.
He's good in it, but the film's bad.
Yeah, I don't know. I think it was just like, hey, it's Robin Williams being creepy. And that's why I was okay with that. Surprisingly, kind of a different take on Robin Williams being creepy in this. And I was okay with that.
Yeah, I thought it was really standard.
I think RV was the point that I went, Robin Williams.
I don't watch movies with 2-letter titles.
There's little bits of really good dialogue in this that I really enjoyed.
Yeah.
I mean, they have kind of the phrases they hit on that, you know, the detective said or he's known for saying because the setup is that Hilary Swank's character kind of did her case study on him. The one that really sticks out in my mind is that when he's on the phone, you know, that's a really heavy scene when he's on the phone talking to his partner's wife, I assume. Any of those scenes in film always intrigues me, like how people deliver that kind of news. Have you ever had to do that?
Have I ever had to tell someone that
someone else is dead, or like a relative? I'm asking you a really heavy question right now.
No, I don't think so.
She says to him, "Don't you fucking arrest him." And you kind of know like the implication of that. It sort of makes you think about it. If she would have just said, "Hey, when you find him, like put a bullet in his head," it wouldn't have had quite the weight of that. And you have to think about it because you know she's like, you know, she's making a point other than directly the words she's saying. The other thing I liked is when he's first talking to Robin Williams on the phone, Finch, his character's name was the writer. When Dormer's first talking to Finch on the phone, Finch says, there's nothing as lonely as not sleeping. It feels like the whole planet is deserted. And I thought that was like spot on too.
Yeah.
They did kind of a good job, I think, with Finch because he's a writer, but he's supposed to be like kind of a trashy writer.
Yeah.
So occasionally he'll use like a bad mix metaphor.
Right.
Or do something a little heavy handed. So there's this thin line when you have a movie in this kind of genre where you have the all-knowing detective.
Yeah.
Can you think of any examples of all-knowing detective in movies?
You got Morgan Freeman in Seven.
Yeah.
That's a really good one.
Yeah. Can you think of bad ones? Because that sticks out to me like a sore thumb sometimes. And I think it's hard to do.
I don't know. There's so many bad ones. I can't think of any in particular. Al Pacino's been in a lot of those.
Yeah. Where it's like the detective is almost a sixth sense. He just knows things and you just go with him.
And he ends up being dead at the end.
You can't make two of those in one show.
Just cut out the first one.
So in the beginning, they do a little bit of that when he first examines the body. Mm-hmm. They have kind of that awkward film moment, which can either be done like... it can be done good or bad. And I think it was done okay in this. I think I'm fine with it. Where the detective comes in and he's just like, none of you guys know what you're doing. Clearly, you know, he trimmed the fingernails and I know that. Yeah. And he just has this whole wealth of information it comes out of nowhere.
I mean, I would take that scene from a different standpoint where he goes in to look at the body. And I mean, it's really clear that he's going to go in and he's going to find something they missed.
Right.
Because in every other film of this genre, the detective goes in and he's from out of town. You know, he's from LA or New York, depending on where the film takes place. Right. Maybe Chicago.
No, never Chicago. Chicago's in four films.
He's hardened. So he comes in and they've already like started the case. So he's like, can I look at the body? And they're like, oh yeah, did you read the report? And he always inevitably goes, I want to do it myself.
Yeah. Or goes fuck in the there, report.
Goes in there and then like turns over the body and there's the name of the killer. And he goes, why didn't you see this? Yeah. And they're just like, we weren't looking that hard.
And they just bumble around and like, we're from Alaska.
Yeah.
And, yeah.
This one did it better in that he picked out a bunch of things and they're like, yeah, that was in the report. And then he finds this like arbitrary thing, like the fact that the nails were cut and it doesn't matter.
Yeah, it doesn't lead him to the right conclusion. Right. Remember, he's all like, oh, maybe this guy, well, he kind of says something that makes everyone else think this guy's killed before. And he's like, nobody's going to kill again. And that turns out to not maybe be the situation. Yeah, who knows, but not in the way that it's a focus situation.
Yeah,
exactly.
And I would credit the movie in that even though he found something like, you know, payoff.
Yeah.
But it wasn't something that mattered.
And I think that scene's more set up for how, you know, he's kind of taking charge. It's a different way of doing that thing, you know, they do in movies.
The hot fuzz thing?
Yeah. Well, that and the kind of, you know, oh, this is out of your jurisdiction or this division's taken, I'm in charge now, right. You know, that kind of thing. And they set it up by using sort of a different device. And I really like that.
So when we were first looking at these films, when we were making the lists for what films we own that the other had not seen, I asked you, or I told you rather that Insomnia wasn't entirely a new film for me. A while ago, my sister had rented it and I had like walked through the room and stopped, but I didn't see the film. I did not see enough of it to even claim to know what it was about.
Yeah.
The only scene I saw was the scene with Al Pacino chasing Robin Williams across the floating logs.
Yeah.
The Frogger scene.
Yeah.
And that turned me off of the film, which I mean, I don't understand why. I still don't understand why it was in the film. But we were talking about it during the film and kind of realized that it's in all of them.
This is kind of a staple of the genre. It seems like, you know, just off the top of my head, I mean, Seven's got one. Seven has that kind of Brad Pitt chases the killer, gets shot, you know, whatever scene.
Yeah.
And then, you know, I'm pretty sure Blade Runner has one. I mean, a lot of these...
they've all got them.
Yeah. just seems like a necessary thing to do in the genre.
Well, I don't know. I think that's one of the things that the genre needs to evolve out of.
Really?
I think in order to make a really decent film, this film didn't need that. It served zero purpose.
But once you put that scene in context, it's not as bad as walking through it. If I'd walked by, you know, if I was like channel surfing, which I haven't done that in a decade, if I came upon people running across logs, I would not be interested in that. That wouldn't make me stay on that. I think it's this way of incorporating a little bit of action within the film.
Right.
The film feels action-packed in a way that it's cut really well.
Mm-hmm.
And you constantly feel like, you know, there's tension building or there's a lot going on when really it's just people kind of investigating.
Yeah.
Which is something hard to do and sort of, I wouldn't call this a mystery, but
yeah.
Something of this sort.
I want to wrap this around to talk about the director. So Christopher Nolan, you're way more into Christopher Nolan than I am.
Sure.
I'm going to come right out and like, I don't know if you're under the impression that I'm a huge Christopher Nolan fan.
Oh no. We talked about The Prestige earlier.
I think Christopher Nolan for you is Neil Marshall for me. I've seen Christopher Nolan films.
Probably seen as many as me at this point.
That's probable.
Okay.
And none of them stand out as great films to me.
I don't think he's an amazing director. I wouldn't call him a visionary or anything.
However, I would also like to say that this film didn't feel like a Christopher Nolan film to me.
You don't think so?
No. I was disappointed that this was a Christopher Nolan film.
Really?
It seemed really standard for me.
Mm-hmm.
It seemed like a really standard film. Like, and I didn't like Memento,
mm-hmm.
but it seemed visionary. And Christopher Nolan's kind of got this style, this super stylized, like, Memento and Prestige are really good examples. Like, yeah. I would say The Dark Knight, but that's its own beast.
Well, you know what I like about that, and I was going to bring this up too, is that that's one of the things that really made me like Christopher Nolan. I felt like this being one of his earlier films was a little gimmicky as far as the style went.
Yeah.
Which I still think went over perfectly. I'm totally okay with it. But when he started taking over The Dark Knight stuff, he left out a lot of these signature Christopher Nolan things.
Yeah, because like, twitchy scenes and stuff.
Yeah, because Dark Knight is its own thing. It doesn't need to feel like Christopher Nolan.
Well, I think that's a credit to him.
When a director knows kind of what his signature thing is and doesn't want to incorporate it into
it's another machine, yeah.
Right. It's like when Tarantino was supposed to do Casino Royale when mm-hmm. those rumors were floating around.
Yeah.
And I kind of worried that, you know, Tarantino taking on a different franchise would be too much Tarantino and not enough franchise.
Right.
But I definitely credit him for being able to separate those.
The point I want to make is that I don't think Christopher Nolan is exceptional as a director, but I will say that although, and it was an understatement when I said this isn't my favorite genre, mm-hmm. I tend to dislike this genre greatly. This was not bad, not a bad film. And I would credit that to Christopher Nolan for keeping it cut the way that it needs to be seen instead of like, if you're a genre junkie watching films like this, you're like, yeah, well, that's just because that's how things are in this genre. Kind of like when
that's not an excuse.
It's kind of like when I show you horror films and I'm like, well, that's just the way things go in horror films. And you're like, oh, that doesn't make sense. I'm like, it's just part of the, it's part of the camp.
Yeah.
Christopher Nolan cut this down to be a film instead of a genre piece.
Yeah.
And that's something that I would credit it a lot for as a film, as well as just, you know, him as a director.
And I think you've stumbled onto something that makes us both like our appropriate genres here is that I know that in your head, as well as mine, we're going, how can we take this genre and like get rid of really the campiness of it?
Yeah.
I mean, campy, the word campy is thrown around in horror a lot, but I think that's fine for noir detective mm-hmm. stuff too, to look at a movie and go, all right, well, this is what you do in a genre like this. How can you kind of modify that so that people who aren't just genre junkies, as you would say, can appreciate said film? One of Nolan's things, and he seemed to really like cut it down with each new film he does, he relies on it less. And maybe that's because it's kind of a crutch, kind of a gimmick, or you're just trying to, as an artist, you're always just trying to do new stuff or whatever. But this movie has a lot of those kind of little flashes, little clips. The one, if you've seen Memento, this isn't really a spoiler, but if you've seen Memento, there's a particular scene when he's sleeping and there's kind of that kind of scare shot where he's, there's a quick audio sound and that shot of his wife like suffocating to death.
Mm-hmm.
Sounds like suffocating to death would be a spoiler, but it's really not, I promise you.
Sounds like suffocating to death would be redundant, but apparently it's not either.
I think the clips in this kind of added a little bit of character to the film. It's one of those things that made it stylized for starters. But what really made me think the clips were kind of more necessary, you get a lot of these fast scenes where you see the girl laughing in mm-hmm. the beginning. you know, and it's as they're kind of going through and investigating the crime scenes and her, you know, her bedroom and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And they'll look at a particular article of clothing or jewelry and you'll see a quick clip of her laughing. And you're just like, oh, whatever. Look at the poor happy girl. She was murdered. And then later you find out that he killed her, maybe by accident, maybe not. Right. He wasn't being very careful.
Yeah.
Because she was laughing at him. And he felt ridiculed and he couldn't handle it and he tried to shut her up. And I didn't really realize that until I watched it for a second time that, oh yeah, all these laughing scenes kind of have a double meaning to them. The other thing with the editing of this I kind of liked, and we'll talk about the treatment of insomnia a little bit too. The scene where the insomnia is first really starting to hit him and he walks in the office, remembering like the fans are going and the staplers and stuff. And just the mix of like audio on that, as well as how quick it is cut from scene to scene. I really like that too. That was
possibly the most Christopher Nolan part of the film.
Yeah. Maybe that's why I think it's a taste thing with Christopher Nolan, you know, because I like music like that. That's really cut up and choppy like that. And I think it's the same thing with film. I can really appreciate that from an editing standpoint. And it's just something like aesthetically that I really enjoy.
Yeah.
For whatever reason, neither you or myself are big on the sleeping.
Yeah.
I've avoided this movie called Insomnia for a long time because I hate the treatment of insomnia in film.
Yeah, it's always weird. Or, I don't know, it's either, there's basically two extremes and nothing in between.
Yeah.
Where either you don't sleep for maybe like, I don't know, a whopping 17 hours and you start seeing your dead parents like in 10 places at once, all like having sex with puppies.
Yeah.
And then there's the other extreme. A person like will not sleep. And they'll go on for like 80 days not sleeping and they'll just be like hard line. Like, I know exactly what I'm doing. Kind of,
they'll be mad.
Yeah. They'll just be angry and everybody will revere them as nuts.
Yeah. 17 hours not sleeping is what kids do for finals.
Mm-hmm.
Like that's nothing. There was a show on Comedy Central called Insomniac. And that seems like the general population's view of insomnia is just kind of, it's this cutesy little word for when you don't sleep for a couple extra hours.
Yeah. Right.
I don't know where you've gone on that, but I think I've probably exceeded anything that was even talked about in the film to like pretty unhealthy standards. And I think this film did it really well, not just from an artistic standpoint with like audio and visual cues, but just the way they talked about it. First of all, the film's called Insomnia, but it's not really about insomnia.
Not even remotely.
It's just something they kind of touch on and it ties really well into the story, especially being with the Alaska thing.
Yeah.
And that's one of the main reasons I like this film. Is you have a film that almost deceives you in what you know what could have ruined that is at the end in the dying scene if he's dying there and he's just like, I'm so tired, I just have insomnia, and then the credits roll. Best titular line ever.
He's laying there about to fall asleep and he's like, finally the silence of the lambs.
Where they talk about early on like the flashes and the tricks of light. And so for people who have not had actual insomnia, I would say I identify best with flashes or tricks of light.
Yeah.
I wouldn't go so far as to call them full-on hallucinations, but you see things that aren't quite there.
Yeah. And a lot of like visual zoning and lighting becomes strange, which they really did a good job of. And then, I mean, the obvious one is the focus, right?
Yeah.
They touched on that, but... The biggest one for me is that it's the lighting. Like, I think the really good illustration of that is when she comes into the motel room, whatever.
Sure.
Flips the light on and it's just fucking bright as hell.
Yeah.
That's exactly what it looks like to be up for 5 days.
Yeah. Yeah. Where the lights are off and your eyes have adjusted so much that it just seems like kind of dim room light.
And you're like out, you're like out in the sunlight and it just hurts. It's everything's white.
It's just painful. Yeah.
Yeah.
So the first time he's trying to sleep too. And I don't know if you do this either, but you remember my old room, the windows were just like boarded off. You get like these little slivers of light and you blame them for not sleeping. You're just like, if that sliver of light wasn't there, and you cover it, and then again, your eyes readjust and then you find another one.
Yeah.
And it just seems like there's just like searing blades of light in your room at all times. And it's terrible. One of the best ones for me though, I think, was when he's in the car at the end. And it's focusing on the windshield wipers because that'll be, and the camera like follows them as if they prop the camera on another set of windshield wipers. It's just following them perfectly and kind of cutting between the two of them. Just really good editing again. And then he hears the truck that isn't actually there, the car or whatever. Which is also kind of a little bit of a callback from the earlier scene when he's driving dead on into the SUV or whatever. Right. And kind of spins out and notices it wasn't even there at all. Mm-hmm. Just little things like that to let you know the insomnia is getting to him without actually a scene where he's talking to someone like, man, this insomnia, it's really getting to me. I don't know if you remember, I think I called you and told you about this the first time I saw the film because I was interested to see if you'd seen it or not yet. And I remember telling you one of the things I liked about it most was like the overall theme of the story.
Mm-hmm.
So the ending gets a little theme heavy with the sort of deathbed scene with the whole, you know, death doc scene. Yeah, right. I've realized the error of my ways kind of thing,
mm-hmm.
which usually that's the heavy handed stuff I have to overlook. Scenes in movies right. where they're trying to blatantly display
where
a point of view.
They put a bow on the film.
A little bit of that. I think for me, it's more so when they're trying to say, in case you didn't get it so far, right. here's the point. Okay, so here's the moral of the story. The it's one of those scenes.
Yeah.
And the biggest reason I think I hate those scenes is because I think they're wrong so many times. They make ethical points. You know, a big one for me is always, and I think Dogma probably does this, one of those scenes where it's like, it doesn't matter what you believe as long as you believe.
Yeah.
You know, one of those kind of scenes. Right. And I'm like, that is the worst thing anyone can ever say ever.
It's true though. So,
and, clearly it doesn't
film
matter.
Film is film.
But this film hits on a great point I love, which it was kind of like walking a thin line with that the whole time that made me a little uneasy, which is the end justifies the means.
Mm-hmm.
And
you use that a lot, by the way, and how much you hate
that mentality. Because I think it leads to evil. I think some of the worst things in the universe come from that idea. And this film is a wonderful example of that because all of the bad situations that arise are because he tried to nail these people earlier who he didn't think there was enough evidence, so he planted evidence.
Yep.
And the film goes through and it basically shows you how that screwed him over so many times. Seeing it again, I caught a lot more of them. I mean, okay, so you have that thing, first of all, where he shoots his partner, right? And he only feels he has to cover that up and lie about it because, you know, he's under investigation. And his partner's like dying words, his last thoughts, are that, you know, he shot him on purpose, mm-hmm. which is awful, which is so bad. And he could have just told the truth about that, which would have been the right thing to do. And I'm sure stuff like that happens on the job sometimes and whatever, but he couldn't because he already looks like a sketchy guy.
Right.
And then you have the scene where Finch has recorded their conversation. Now, if you're just telling the truth all the time and you're never trying to like lie to get what you want, it might be a little harder overall. But you know, if he had taped the conversation, it wouldn't mean anything because he's just an honest guy saying stuff. He mm-hmm. wouldn't have that evidence against him.
Right.
Which means he wouldn't have to go find a gun and create all this trouble and whatever.
Well, the film would have been, you know, 20 minutes.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, there's that thing too. There's the Juno gets the abortion thing.
Yeah, right? Juno gets the abortion. By the way, Juno didn't get an abortion.
Spoiler alert.
And then the film didn't end.
So they draw this parallel with the end justifies the means thing between Finch, who has killed someone he believes by accident, and between Dormer, who has killed his partner by accident, and Finch tries to convince him that they're in the same boat, that they're really the same guy.
Quite literally are.
Yeah, right. They really are in the same boat when they're having that conversation. That's awesome. But figuratively as well, too. And I think that starts to make him question for the first time if the things he's been doing are right or not. And it's only really as he's dying and she's about to throw out the, you know, the shell casing.
Yeah.
You get someone who hasn't been jaded by all these years of working and they're still young and idealistic. And he's kind of like, yeah, you're on the right path. You shouldn't fuck up like I did. And right. I really appreciate that. I think that's such a great point to make in this film.
Yeah. I mean, I know they bring it up, but it's still pretty subtle.
Mm-hmm.
You kind of have to be making bullet points during the film to kind of get the big, you know, star ending where this is what that was all about.
Yeah, for sure.
And even though they bring it up, it's not, you know, in your face and over the top.
The same way they do the insomnia thing.
Yeah. It's just subtlety, cut dry and that's what it is. And then they're like, sweet. And now credits.
Mm-hmm.
They just wrap it up. It's really nice. That's Christopher Nolan. He does packages with this film, which I really like.
I have to do the disclaimer thing again when we talk about The Rock.
What disclaimer?
Because I don't know if you were aware of this. I think you knew. Not everyone who watched The Rock with us knew. But it turns out there isn't a JFK conspiracy.
Oh, yeah.
And also no Roswell cover-up.
None. Except the McDonald's.
Yeah, except the
Roswell. Which is covered up by a UFO.
Right. The Roswell tourist McDonald's that we have to go see.
So The Rock. How'd you feel about The Rock?
I hate to do this to you. This is going to happen finally. The Rock was the worst film we saw.
Really?
You know, I'm hesitant to say this about films because I feel like I'm going to hurt Michael Bay's feelings, but I question if that was a movie.
Really?
Dude, how
can you like Die Hard and not The Rock?
I think Die Hard...
Or at least, how can you say Die Hard is a film and The Rock is not?
All throughout the film, I was going, you know what? Die Hard did something here that The Rock should have done instead. Die Hard has character and it is a film. It's, you know, it's popcorny, it's action, and it knows that.
Oh, for sure.
But it has like a pretty heavy underlying story, which kind of, it assists all of the jokes and kind of moves the plot along. Not in the second, which is why I hate the second Die
Hard. I thought the second's okay. It's just kind of, there's too much, too much boom and too little talking.
But it's what Die Hard 4 got wrong, which is that it's, I guess I would call it a headless action movie. Right from the get-go with The Rock, it was like that. It's a series of like, I imagine like children playing with trucks, you know? I wouldn't make the noises into this microphone now because it'll probably just make everything peak and sound awful in your headphones.
Yeah.
But it's just lots of explosion noises and trucks crashing together. And I mean, it's good for that. I had fun watching it. It was great. We had people over. Not sure I'd say it's a film. So it did little things that, going through the first thing that I really liked about it, Michael Bay is, I will credit him, and you would disagree with me about this in Transformers and maybe
other ones of his films. I did not like Transformers.
I would say that, I didn't like Transformers either, but
about Transformers. Okay.
I would credit Transformers for having special effects and modeling work way ahead of its time.
I've seen much better.
I think it did a really good job with that stuff, but okay, that's not the point.
Mm-hmm.
The point is that there's a lot of things, there aren't a lot of things. There's a few things Michael Bay does really well, but they're explosions and stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, I feel like if he did second unit, I would love to have Michael Bay doing my second unit stuff, but I don't want him in charge of my film.
Right.
Particularly, probably the best shot in the whole film for me is when the explosion lifts the streetcar. Yeah, the trolley off of the ground.
Yeah.
And like way off the ground, right? Not like, it exploded bounced a little bit, but it like
four or five stories.
Yeah, it's like it was
a pillar of fire.
It became a plane all of a sudden, which was incredible. And there's a lot of really good shots like that. There's a lot of eye candy in the movie.
Mm-hmm.
Even the viral weapon was, you know, bright, shiny green in a crystal ball. But there's a lot of things that the movie did wrong, which makes it unacceptable to me as candy.
Like what?
There's a few points where you have to kind of dismiss things. It's a suspension of disbelief sort of thing.
Well, are you talking like technological things?
No, not necessarily. Okay. And I mentioned this during the film as well, but I kind of put this movie in the era before people had the internet, so I let them get away with more stuff. So it's what, 92, 93?
Mm-hmm.
So people couldn't just go on Google and be like, does this really make sense? They can't Google JFK and figure it out, you know?
No.
So little suspension of disbelief stuff. The first thing for me was when Sean Connery first gets out, and he's kind of an escape artist and whatever. Okay. So he gets out and he goes to talk to his daughter and everything's going fine for me. So all of the squad cars surround him. And so he doesn't want his daughter to know that he's escaped or whatever. So Nicolas Cage kind of helps him out. And he goes, oh yeah, you're part of our special task unit. Time to go, right? But all the cops are surrounding him, pointing guns at him. You know, and it's this amount of suspension of disbelief that to me just shows that people weren't paying attention when they made the film.
Well, I don't know. They never go back to it and they never necessarily say that she bought it.
Sure. But
I think what you're supposed to take away from that scene I'm going to say right now that I don't want to get into the tactics of this film because it's not a film tactic film.
Yeah.
But I think that what you're supposed to take away from that scene is, oh, look, Stanley Goodspeed's a nice guy. And, you know, albeit that John Mason is this hardened criminal, Stanley Goodspeed still wants him to, you know, be okay.
Sure.
I think that's what you're supposed to take away from that. But again, I totally agree. Like if it were to be analyzed on a film level, that's lame.
Yeah.
And
there's a lot of
things.
Really,
it's a transparent thing that you could easily fix. That just seems like, we won't do that.
Uh-huh. The kind of the formula that, that's used in a movie like this. So let's just deal with this one particularly. Yeah. Through the execution, there are things that I agree with and things I don't agree with.
Mm-hmm.
The special effects and the explosions, I can enjoy. I take them in fully. It's, I think, a lot of the comedic value of a movie like this. And I think it's half and half.
Yeah.
You know, it bills itself as an action film, but I think it's supposed to be kind of lighthearted and
funny.
Well,
it's got the John McClane moments.
Yeah,
I think it's probably the best idea to compare this to Die Hard, which I think you and I agree is a greatly executed action film.
Right.
Probably par for good action film.
Well, and is also a great example because I think Die Hard 4 failed miserably. Yep. And I think we can take a couple, you know, a couple notes out of each of those. So the movie had a lot of jokes kind of sprinkled throughout. Mm-hmm. And almost none of them were funny to me.
I think that some of them are funny, but that's also probably because I was laughing at them as jokes.
Right.
But not at like laughing at the joke.
Right. Well, in order to enjoy a movie like this, it kind of cheats you into it because you have to, if you're not laughing at the jokes they want you to laugh at, if you don't kind of force yourself to laugh, like they separate the action in such a way that you need like, you physically need to exhale into laughter in certain points to continue enjoying the action.
Right.
And if you're not laughing along with, you know, the certain one-liners that are being thrown out, then you're going to enjoy the next piece of action less. So it's kind of like a thing where everyone goes, ha, that was a joke.
Yeah.
There was one. I spotted the joke. And I don't know. That feels really weak to me. And I don't like that.
That's fair.
In Die Hard, and again, this could just be a taste thing. In Die Hard, the jokes were funny to me. There were fewer and further between. And there were less, and this is something I despise Michael Bay for, there were less just like stereotypical characters. And that's what does it for me in Die
Hard. That's something that I definitely noted is that everybody that's not one of the like speaking roles. Well, no, I take that back. Anybody that's not a name, that character whose character does not have a name is a total stereotype. And even some of the characters with names are.
Well, and they try and fool you because they take Sean Connery and they take Nicolas Cage and both of them get kind of fleshed out detail.
Yeah.
You kind of, Nicolas Cage has a thing about music.
And you get a little with Ed Harris too.
Yeah, sure, sure. And beyond that, none of them have anything. They're all just complete nothing.
Shady, blurred backgrounds. You know that. Yep. You know that the one guy
red
with
shirts,
the
really.
Yeah, the one guy with the like bottom teeth.
Yeah,
he's just kind of like schizo, angry, like twitchy, angry. And then Tony Todd, who I'm gonna just take. Can I take a Tony Todd moment?
Sure, please.
All right, Tony Todd time.
Tony
with
Todd moment.
Tony Todd's in this film. Tony Todd is one of who I consider the big three in horror film. We discussed it when we watched Hatchet, I think.
Mm-hmm.
So go fucking watch Hatchet. But Tony Todd's in this film, and he was also in The Crow.
Mm-hmm.
And in this film, he plays, I don't know, I'm not even going to pretend to know the guy's name, the Rocket Man.
Yeah.
He plays Rocket Man.
Uh-huh.
And Tony Todd, I he's good in this film. His character's good. He acts well. His character has a lot more base to it, although I don't think that the film gave it to him. I think he took it and kind of created the character on his own.
So like he had a pretty flat character.
Yeah, I think they're just like, you're the guy that's going to die here. They give him a character. They tell him where he comes in, his lines, and then
and what
where
the
he
joke
ends.
Is when he dies.
Yeah.
And
And I think he was just like, okay, well, I'm going to make him this guy. And they're like, that's fine. So Tony Todd, I think characters, there were other characters like him, which is why I'm one of the reasons I'm bringing this up. But where actors made them more fleshed out than the actual film did.
Yeah.
Because like there were no details about Tony Todd's character.
Yeah.
However, I felt like I was more familiar with him than a lot of the other characters. Even some of the characters that I would consider bigger characters, like the guy who I wish I remembered his name. He plays Hack on TV. You know him as the guy with red hair from 12 Monkeys.
Yeah.
His character I think is supposed to be really important.
Yeah.
I know nothing about
that
character.
Well, because in the end,
he's
he
an old
tries
friend.
To take the power.
But
he's not, because none of them are characters.
Right.
They're all stand-ins, you know?
Mm-hmm.
The guys who did the stand-in for the lighting and framing of this movie could have just as easily done the acting. And in some cases, probably did.
Better. Or done better.
Oh, yeah. Or done way better. Yeah. And that's something you don't want to do in your film. You don't want to leave it open for, in rare cases, it works out great. But in most cases, it means you have bad writers to write a film and go, well, hopefully the actors will bring something to the table.
Right. I think they just lucked out too, because I think that it seems like wanton random casting for this film.
Yeah.
It seems like a bunch of
people were coming from everywhere.
Seems like a bunch of people tried out and they're just like, yeah, you can do that. And I mean, it just turns out like that a lot of actors that I'm pretty into made this film. Nick Cage, who I was more into before a film where he had a flaming skull called The Weatherman.
It's just been straight. It's just been straight downhill for me from there.
I think,
I'm skeptical of Nicolas Cage.
Granted, the epitome of his career was the film before that, Werewolf Woman of the SS.
Oh, right. Of course. An excellent film. You should really pick it up if you can find it.
Yeah, if you can find it. If you want to see a trailer for it, it's probably on YouTube.
It's probably
nowhere. Then, you know, you'll find the trailer. You can just go rent the film at
you can't even get a hold of
local
that trailer.
Rental place.
That's awful.
But what else was I going to say? William Forsythe, who is Rob Zombie favorite actor. He's in Devil's Rejects and Halloween.
Mm-hmm.
He shows up in this film.
Yeah.
His character's got nothing. His character has nothing. He's a badass, like... He's a business cop, I guess you could call him.
Yeah, right.
He's a suit cop, like fucking
Al Pacino.
Al Pacino, but less tough. Uh-huh. And then a bunch of random faces that I recognize, but no characters with character.
Right.
Just kind of characters with positions on the screen.
And here's the problem with that is try and imagine this movie and then try and take out all the people you know as actors and replace them with people you've never heard of. And the movie instantly vanishes.
Yeah.
And then when you go back and think about it, now some movies, The Matador, perfect mm-hmm. example. There's a movie driven by Pierce Brosnan.
For sure.
Right. And it's because his character is great and he's a great actor in the spot and whatever. If you then try and place, okay, so we've done that. We're doing a little thought experiment here.
Mm-hmm.
We take all of the people you recognize at all mm-hmm. out of The Rock, right? Because they're your friends.
Which is most
at this
of
point.
The cast.
They're cinematic friends, mm-hmm. right? They're faces you recognize and
familiar,
okay, that's cool.
Yeah.
You take them all out and you go, okay, it's empty. So those must all just be great actors that bring things to the table. But then you put them back in and you realize that their characters weren't really.
Right.
It's just that you recognize faces and right. that kind of helps you along right. with a film.
For most of the actors, definitely. I would say, again, some exceptions.
Yeah, sure.
But for the most part, yeah. Okay, so I'm going to take another aside here.
Sure.
I like the film. I don't want to, like, I mean, I'm willing to concede that it's not a great film.
Yeah.
Because it's not. It's, I mean, it's formula and it's action and it's kaboom Michael Bay.
Michael Bay kind of reminds me of, like, the old comics with the big explosive boom, bang, pows.
Yeah.
If you just, like, erase everything but the boom, bang, pow, and that's just what you're reading right. in a comic book.
I like Michael Bay's, the only other film that I like by him is The Island. I haven't seen Pearl Harbor, but it's bad.
I will say to you that I like The Island the most, and I came out of the theater almost.
But again, that could be actors. You got Sean Bean, you got mm-hmm. Steve Buscemi, and you got Ewan McGregor.
Yeah, yeah.
Those are strong roles.
Yeah, and that was Scarlett Johansson too,
yeah.
and I liked her in that.
Yeah, but she's not a great actor.
And the story I thought was good.
Yeah,
you know?
Really
I really
good.
Liked the story.
It was an interesting story.
I feel more like Michael Bay ruined it by being the
yeah.
director
well,
on it.
Well, there weren't too many explosions until they got to the
yeah.
future San Francisco or
yeah,
LA
right.
or wherever. But speaking of San Francisco, see what I did there?
Yeah.
The Rock, it's a formula film. Like, you know, start to finish, as soon as it starts, you know how it will end.
Yeah.
I mean, granted, I think it follows a formula, but I don't think it does it badly. I would say, and I think it's interesting that we chose the two films that we did together because Insomnia is a formula film.
Yeah, that's true.
And it doesn't do it poorly.
No.
As soon as Insomnia starts, I could have told you, okay, this is the general hazy way it will end.
Yeah, sure.
But this film's another formula film. I think as a formula film, it does exactly what you expect. It throws in a little, like, you know, a few random curveballs that, like, barely apply.
Mm-hmm.
But I think overall, the strength of the film for me comes, one, from the acting.
Mm-hmm.
And two, I really like the concept. And this is maybe something that I can maybe, like, turn you around on. I really like the concept of military turning against the government. And especially the reasoning behind it.
Mm-hmm.
The whole government doing, like, bullshit things and not repaying the people that
yeah.
they owe.
Yeah, for
and
sure.
so the military takes it out on them using their own shit that they shouldn't have anyway.
Yeah.
It's a real, like, look what the government has done, and it's just the government, like, pointing its finger back at itself.
That brings up a really interesting point, because that was the big kind of thing I wanted to talk about here. I have, I would disagree with you on that, actually, but
okay.
for a kind of a really particular reason that it doesn't matter. And this is the problem I kind of have with Shoot 'Em Up, too, which Shoot 'Em Up is a film I enjoy. I've seen it several times. You know, you did it at a double feature, mm-hmm. and I'm behind it.
I love Shoot 'Em Up.
I have problems when a film that... wants to just kind of be an action, enjoyable, whatever film, kind of treads into political territory or serious mm-hmm. territory for any other reason than pure comedic value. If you want to make, like, political jokes, that's totally fine on either side, whatever you want to do. And I'm totally with that, you know, because humor is funny. Okay. Mm-hmm. But this film kind of, Shoot 'Em Up gets a little political about gun control, which makes me a little
I think
uneasy.
It's kind of funny. I think
it's mostly comedic value. It just makes me
uneasy.
Well,
it's got
to
be because Clive Owen's character is for gun control.
Yeah, right. right. So I don't know. It's something internally I have to deal with. It's not Shoot 'Em Up's problem. But with this film, they're trying to portray the bad guys as not that bad. And I understand, like, what you're saying with the military revolt.
I think, and this is probably something you don't like, and you can get right back into what you're saying, but
sure.
I think it's a lesser of two evils thing. And that's another thing along the lines of end justifies the means that you hate.
Right. Yeah. I do despise both of those. For that, it's simpler than that. For me, it's just violence.
Yeah.
You know, that's all it is. I mean, I would totally agree with them. I would agree if they protest. I agree if they, you know, if they're going to like, even if they're doing something mildly unethical, if they're going to like sabotage information.
Yeah.
I have a problem once you approach violence because that changes the whole game.
Yeah.
Now they're bringing hostages into it, which is another thing I hated in this film. Like if you're going to have hostages, you do one of two things, right? And both of them are awesome. You like dwell on the hostages. To bring this back, we like to reference the same thing over and over in each podcast, kind of have themes.
Yeah.
But Dog Day Afternoon is a perfect example where you're there's hostages and you're talking about that through the whole film. Or the other thing to do is make a joke out of it and say there's hostages and then ignore them.
Mm-hmm.
And the movie brings up hostages just enough to remind you that they're there, but they're not actually important.
Right.
You see them once in the beginning and they're like, huh, funny hostages, they're all trapped. And then it just kind of leaves.
Yeah.
But to go, okay, so I just, before I forget that, I want to point that out. But to go back to the thing where it's trying to make you feel for the bad guys, and it does this from the very beginning because the guy tells the little girls to tell their teacher they want to leave or whatever.
I don't, you probably don't remember this because I never remember it until like today when we watched it. But film starts with Ed Harris at the funeral for those soldiers.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And he's like, this is what I have to do, talking to the gravestone, which I don't know if you knew this, but gravestones can't hear you.
Yeah, turns out.
They're made of stone.
Really easy to talk to the dead, getting them to respond. Yeah, and he goes in. He goes in with guns and really dangerous chemical weapons. And then halfway through the film, they're trying to make you feel for him. Like, he wasn't really going to do it.
Yeah.
He was just kidding, guys. Right. He's like the deadliest weapon on earth. And he's just like, oh, sorry.
He has one of those things we wish we could disinvent.
It's like flying around with an atomic bomb and then accidentally dropping it and being like, oh, I just wanted to wave it around. I'm really sorry about that. Yeah. I'm not a bad guy.
Yeah.
It's gross.
I can see that.
And I don't like trying to make that point with it. You know? There's no reason to go there.
It's not, I don't think it's a point that like,
I feel like Michael Bay in his very simple five-year-old mind was like, yeah, I'm going to have some moral ambiguity.
Yeah.
People don't know who to root for. And I think know who to root for, the ones who aren't slaughtering people. That's it. Easy. All right. So is there anything we forgot?
Tits.
All right, cool. So what movies do you want to do next time?
Next time I will watch From Hell, which I have not seen.
Okay.
And you can watch Autofocus, which I always do this. I'm just going to continue this trend. But whenever you ask me what films we're going to watch, I will always give a detailed analysis of what the one that I've seen is about. And then just say, and also From Hell starring and whoever I know is in it.
Okay.
So Autofocus is the biography about the guy. I can't think of his name right off the top of my head. But the guy that played Hogan from Hogan's Heroes.
All right.
Turns out he had a really seedy lifestyle starring Greg Kinnear as the actual character. And then Willem Dafoe is also in it.
Oh, cool.
It's really good. It's weird. It'll make
Does Willem Dafoe have a Mexican mustache?
No, he's creepier than that. It's better.
Really?
And then also we'll be watching From Hell starring Johnny Depp and has a red cover.
So we don't usually go this far into the future, but since we kind of got the lineup, then we're going to do Slasher Fest.
Oh, Slasher Fest 1.
Yeah.
I want to give it a better name than that.
Do you have one?
I'm going to come up with a better one, but I'll use it on the next podcast, the From Hell podcast. I'll probably segue using From Hell.
All right, great.
But we'll be watching.
I'm letting people know early so they can see all these because it's a lot of movies.
Yeah, we're going to be watching all of the Friday the 13th series.
Great.
And just kind of discussing that. So it'll be big for you. It'll be fun for me.
Right.
Fucking incredible.
If you don't really care about any of the spoilers in that, you can just watch a couple of the films, I guess. Yeah. But we're just going to do the whole
next
podcast
week,
on them.
Is it cool if I like give a little, these are the ones you should watch. These are the ones you can skip.
Yeah, let's do it.
I could probably do that now.
Good.
All right. So for the Friday the 13th series, you're going to have to watch the first one. Then the fourth.
All right.
Sixth, ninth, 10th.
All right. But we're going to watch them all. But those are what
all
people should watch.
Yep.
And then after that, dare I say, hit your Punisher.
Finally.
All right, great. So
awesome.
That is what we're doing.
So it looks like you're going to have to watch more fucking film.
All right, bye.